Let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice, 'cause he wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice.
Love will lead me through. You are the peace. peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. To shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore. I won't fear what tomorrow brings. With each morning, I'll rise and sing. My God's love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are my light, my lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to St Andrew's Church. Good afternoon if you're in the stalls, you've got the best view. Good afternoon in the transept, kind of the upper, the sort of middle circle. Restricted view at the back, good afternoon. And the really cheap seats outside. Give us a cheer if you're outside. Excellent, very good. You are all warmly, warmly welcome to St Andrew's, Rachel's church home for the last 20-something years. As we begin today, just a couple of housekeeping things. If you need the toilet, good luck on the way through. But if you need the toilet, you just need to head through the door on your left, my right, and it's just up in the vestry. And please turn off your mobile phones, or at least put them on Do Not Disturb, lest you become the victim of one of Rachel's first celestial signature eye rolls. At the end of the service, you are warmly invited, in fact, encouraged, to give a donation to St. Teresa's Hospice in Rachel's memory. There's a collection plate at the back, or at the back of your order of service is an online link. Following the service, you are invited to join Paul, Ben, Sam, Colin, Caroline, and the rest of the family at King's Church for Rachel-style afternoon tea refreshments. And so we begin. I'm really sorry to have my back to you, but I'm just going to keep turning. It'll be fine. We are here because we knew and loved Rachel. Today is a day to celebrate. Despite the confusion, the incomprehension, the anger and sadness of the last few weeks, we are here today to celebrate the joy and the love that Rachel brought to each of our lives. So today is not a day for that anger and sadness, though tears are most definitely allowed. In fact, you'll forgive myself, Alison, and the other people here today who are speaking if we have a few during this service, because this is a service for someone we loved. It's a service for a friend by friends. Today, we celebrate her living, which is why you see no coffin here today, because we remember her alive and we remember her smiling. You will all have come with a million different reasons to celebrate Rachel, a million different things that she meant to you. Some will be big memories of the far-flung exotic places that she travelled, or the big events that you might have been part of with her, but most will be small, day-to-day things, because it is those day-to-day things that made Rachel someone worth celebrating. For those that don't know me, my name's Sarah, and about 20 years ago, I found a friend. As a new mum, I looked to Rachel in awe. She had an 8-month-old baby and was so organised. Never, so it seemed, flapped, always had everything that Ben might need. We met for coffee, she dettoled the high chair. This is never something I will live up to, I thought. This is not somebody who I can be really friends with. But then I got to know her properly. On the day we confided our shared and secret love of Doner kebabs, when sober, we would be friends for life. And now, my friend, I'm sorry, your secret is out. You will remember her laugh. You will have made her laugh. She will have made you laugh. You will remember her care and her love, often through the medium of cake. You will remember her indignant snort and her classic eye roll when something happened that fell short of her expectations. You will remember her little legs dangling on almost every chair she ever sat on. But you may have known her as Big Rich. You will remember the messages you exchanged. Thankfully, the vicar's not here, because a lot of them were exchanged during services and PCC meetings. You will remember the drinks you shared, the hot tubs you shared. You'll remember the way her nose crinkled when she smiled. Our lives are better today because of Rachel's part in them. And that is why we can celebrate. You might remember or been part of her singing. Your Christmas memories might be like mine, her singing the descant verse, thank you, Paul, for the vocabulary, the descant verse of O Come All Ye Faithful, the third verse. So today, as we celebrate, we will sing. It might not sound like a choir of angels, but we're here to give it our best shot. Worship was such an important part of Rachel's life. And these new words to this old hymn feel very relevant. The hymn is "Great is thy faithfulness." But there's some new words. "Then, without warning, desire or deserving, I found my treasure, my pleasure in thee." And then to the classic line, "Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside." So we're going to stand. We're going to sing "Great is thy faithfulness." We're going to celebrate the bright hope that Rachel wanted for all of us as we go forward. Her passing certainly did feel like it was without warning, but we celebrate today the blessing she was to us and 10,000 beside. Let's stand. please do take a seat. I want to move to the first of our readings from the Bible now, and I'd like to invite Alan to read from the book of Ecclesiastes. Thank you.
Ecclesiastes chapter 3, reading verses 1 to 14. Everything on earth has its own time and its own season. There is a time for birth and death, planting and reaping, for killing and healing, destroying and building, for crying and laughing, weeping and dancing, for throwing stones and gathering stones, embracing and parting. There is a time for finding and losing, keeping and giving, for tearing and sowing, listening and speaking. There is also a time for love and hate, for war and peace. What do we gain by all our hard work? I have seen what difficult things God demands of us. God makes everything happen at the right time. Yet none of us can ever understand all he has done. And he puts questions in our minds about the past and the future. I know the best thing we can do is to always enjoy life, because God's gift to us is the happiness we get from our food and drink and from the work we do. Everything God has done will last forever. Nothing he does can ever be changed. God has done all this so that we will worship him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Alan. During our service this afternoon, we're going to hear from a few different people who knew and loved Rachel at different times throughout her life. And so we're going to, it sounds a little bit like Adrian Mole, but we're going to the growing up years. We're going to the ripping years. And so I'd like to invite Rebecca, Nick, Sarah, Barry and Sue, if you'd like to come up and share with us your celebrations of Rachel. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Rachel was born on the 25th of August 1974 at Southmead Hospital in Bristol to proud parents Nancy and Colin Froude. She was baptised on the 12th of January 1975 at Holy Trinity Church, Stapleton in Bristol, not Stapleton down the road. I think it must have been on her house buying checklist to always live in or near a place called Stapleton. It's an incredible privilege to have the opportunity to tell you about the Rachel I know. Our journey started in 1977 when the floods moved in to Wellsford Road opposite the Froudes. I was 2, my sister Hannah was 4, and my brother hadn't even been thought of. Rachel, a neighbour at first, and then the closest of playmates, our respective gardens were always open to each other. I say only gardens because our parents only let us play indoors in the worst of weather conditions. Caroline came along in March 1978, which gave Rachel a beautiful little sister to nurture, and gave us all an extra member of our growing Wellsford Road gang, which we were all thrilled about. From memory, when Rachel didn't have her head in a Famous Five or Mallory Towers book, she was keen to organise us all into making perfumes in a jam jar, using the petals from many of Colin's beautifully kept rose bushes. Obviously, we told Uncle Colin that it was the dead petals that had fallen that we were using, not the ones still attached. Sorry, Nancy and Colin, for the damage we did. Rachel always made sure we lived by the rules our parents had set for us. She was a fantastic role model for us all. For example, Rachel made sure we never went past the lavender bush down the road so that we didn't stray too far from home. However, Rachel was always happy for us all to manipulate the railings in her back garden so that we could all squeeze through to play in the school grounds of the Colstons' private boys' school. Trespassing was okay in those days. Rachel was comfortable with that and ensured the railings were put back correctly. We were never caught. Another of Rachel's many lovely attributes was her observation skills. My mum fondly recalls how when Rachel was very young, she pointed out to my mum, "Auntie Wendy, do you know you have bits all over your carpet?" My mum wasn't as good at housework as Nancy. My mum also remembers how Rachel and Caroline's shoes were polished beautifully the night before Sunday school each week. My mum would wake up late on a Sunday morning and ended up having to clean our shoes with furniture polish, which Rachel would pick up on in the car on the way to the church hall, saying, "Auntie Wendy, I can smell furniture polish." Caught red-handed again. Along with many picnics and paddling pools in the gardens, there were walks to snuff mills, blackberry picking, and hours spent playing at the cricket club whilst Uncle Colin played cricket. We were watching you, honestly. Rachel looked after us all and made sure we remembered our manners. We all attended Glenfroom Primary School and later St Mary Redcliffe School in Bristol. Glenfroom inspired us all, with Rachel as our leader, to lay on a gymnastics display for our parents and neighbours. Rachel named this day Skillness Day and ensured we all wore our black leotards. I would like to say our audience were enthralled, but I think in reality they were bored stiff. Rachel, I'm grateful for having known you and for having been part of your life. Thank you for a long and very special friendship. I hope your boys were as mischievous as we were, and I hope you passed on your perfume-making skills to them. Thank you.
So, I lived further down Walter Road, past the lavender bush. Being a year above Rachel, I didn't really get to know her, despite going to the same primary school, until she started at St Mary Redcliffe Secondary School in 1985, and we shared the bus journeys to the other side of Bristol, that I really got to know her. At St Mary Redcliffe, she excelled in English language and literature, developing a love of Jane Austen, the Bronte sisters, and Anne of Green Gables. She loved singing and joined the choir at school and also sung at our local church, Holy Trinity. There were a few of us from Stapleton who got the bus to St Mary Redcliffe, and Rachel was very vocal on her thoughts of our frequent immature behaviour and current love interests. Our church in Stapleton had a very, very good cipher group, a young person's church group. Rachel was a regular and loved attending, especially the annual safari suppers. Viv Robinson, who led the group all those years ago, remembers Rachel as follows. "My overriding memories of Rachel, both as a child and as a loyal and committed member of Holy Trinity Cipher Group, are of happiness and fun. Rachel was always cheerful and the first to volunteer to take part in our often very silly challenges, as well as being a young person who was very open to the good news of Jesus. I remember some great discussions at Cipher about our faith, and this continued as adults after Rachel left Bristol, when we would share stuff about church, raising boys, and life in general. And it was an honour when Rachel and Paul asked me to be Ben's godfather. As we went into our late teens, Rachel got a job at the local Halfords. She managed to get me a discount on buckets and sponges when a friend and I thought it was a good idea to take up car washing for a bit of extra cash. One of my memories of Rachel was when we were about 18. By then, some of us had started visiting the Merchants, our local pub. On Christmas Eve, we would meet there before heading up the hill to church for midnight mass. Now, as Rachel usually sang in the choir, she wouldn't normally attend, but this one Christmas Eve, Rachel decided that she needed a drink to warm up her vocal cords. We were already there, and it just happened to be my round when Rachel walked in. "What would you like?" I asked her, after the various orders from the other teenagers of cider and black, lager, Bacardi and Coke, etc. "A de bonnet and lemonade, please, Nick," said Rachel. "A what and lemonade," I said. "A de bonnet. It's the Queen's favourite drink, and if it's good enough for the Queen, it's good enough for me." Despite moving to the other end of England, Rachel was amazing at keeping in touch, and we would normally see her and the family when they visited Bristol. We also had a number of memorable visits to Darlington, where Rachel was so welcoming. So I will miss you, Rach, and whenever I see or hear someone ask for a de bonnet, it is not the Queen I will think of, but you.
Rachel and I, and Emma, and Michelle, and Debs, and Doris, met in September 1992, 30 years ago this year, as Rachel kindly pointed out to us in January. We met at Ripon, University College of Ripon, York, St John, which is a teacher training college where Rachel studied education and English literature. We all also lived in the same halls of residence at Harewood Hall. As a student, Rachel was always amazingly organised and sailed through the various teaching practices and essays. Weekends always began with those of us that were still left in Ripon and not gone home for the weekend with a Morrison's pizza and a bottle of wine and a really relaxed, chilled experience. Rachel bloomed wherever she was planted. Within a short space of time, she'd become involved with Holy Trinity Church in Ripon, where she joined in with the house groups and the Adopt a Student Scheme, as well as becoming involved with the children's ministry and the music. She joined the college choir and enjoyed performing in Handel's Messiah, performed at Ripon Cathedral. We all enjoyed going to the college balls at the end of each academic year and Christmas term, where Rachel would always be the most glamorously attired. Rachel's life radiated her faith. I recall when she was making decisions, she'd always look through the lens of faith. When we were in the final year at Ripon, and we're starting to apply for jobs, all wondering where we'd end up, Rachel was just sure that she was to stay on in Ripon. She applied for lots of jobs, but she'd had no offers or anything, and time was creeping towards the end of the academic year. But her faith never wavered. She was absolutely sure that she was where God wanted her to be, and she trusted that God would provide her with a job. One day, a school contacted her for an interview. She'd applied to this school weeks before, and they'd know she'd never heard anything. And for some reason, the school hadn't shortlisted straight after the closing date. Well, Rachel got called for interview, and she got the job. She trusted God, and he provided. Rachel's faith always shone through, and you know that if you'd shared a problem with her, she would be praying about it. I can't do justice in a few minutes to explain how wonderful a friend Rachel was to all of us, not just at Ripon, but throughout the last 30 years. She kept in touch and helped us all to stay connected. As we became wives and mothers, our friendships deepened and bonded. Rachel being a godmother to my daughter and being a much-loved honorary aunt to all of my children. We are blessed to have so many precious memories of time spent together on the beaches of North Cornwall, in America, in Darlington. Although geographical distance separated us, the action-packed days and holiday times were spent enjoying time together, building memories, which are now, of course, even more precious. Rachel was kind, generous, gracious, thoughtful, honest, perceptive, and loving. She would always, always help people if it was at all possible. In 2002, Rachel and Paul demonstrated that loving, caring kindness by travelling the whole length of the country at half term to come and look after my two older toddlers as I was getting over the birth of my third baby. Rachel was brilliant at seeing a need and finding a practical solution. As a really silly example, she invited us up to stay for a little holiday one year, but I was really worried about leaving my dog behind. He was very old. But Rachel didn't hesitate. She just invited the dog to come as well. And so she was just amazingly thoughtful. She was the absolute queen of the picnic. Her organisational skills were amazing. She'd just bring out this bag and box after box after box would come out with all the different foods carefully packaged in. It was quite unforgettable. Rachel had a fantastic sense of fun and humour. The one-liners that she delivered would shock you and have you reeling with laughter at the same time, and some still make me chuckle decades later. Rachel was a great encourager, taking interest in supporting wherever she could. We are so blessed to have known Rachel. And I can only end with one verse from Philippians. Rachel, I thank my God in all my remembrance of you.
Well, we first met Rachel when she came to Ripon as that 18-year-old student. As Sarah said, our church had an adopt-a-student scheme. Well, Rachel wasn't actually our student, but she adopted us anyway. We had a new baby, and it was fantastic to have Rachel and the other students who would come and babysit and spend time with us in return for being fed. Rachel dived into life in Ripon and at our church. She joined our fellowship group, and being who she was, Rachel was also involved in lots of other things at Trinity, making friends with so many people of all ages. She always packed a lot in. Can I just say, if there's anybody here today called Gwyneth, can we apologise in advance for the story we're about to tell? Can I just say, we still like the name Gwyneth.
Rachel would always tell you what she really thought. A week or so before our Beth was born, she and Michelle came round to keep me company, as it was my birthday and Barry was away. We got to talking about baby names, and she expressed horror at the idea of Gwyneth, which at the time was our first choice. Beth ended up being called Beth, and she is forever grateful. Our eldest, Jess, remembers lots of times with Rachel babysitting, always fun. Jess once had her toenails painted blue at a time when she didn't even know that nail polish was something that people did. When she was 5, Jess was very proud to be asked to be a bridesmaid for Rachel and Paul. Rachel and Jess practiced endlessly parading around the house, Rachel with a bath towel tied round her for Jess to hold as a train. I'm not sure who was having more fun. Rachel's love of organising things is legendary. When she and Paul were sorting things out before they went to America, she bequeathed her collection of felt pens to us. I have never known one person to have so many pencil cases, all meticulously arranged to hold a different type of pen. Once they were settled in, we went over to the States to visit and spent a few weeks with Rachel and Paul. Rachel was, of course, the perfect host, endless fun, generous to a fault, and keen that we were able to make the most of our time. It was such a good time to spend with friends, a special time that we all remember.
Talking with friends, even though it's over 25 years since Rachel and Paul lived in Ripon, there are so many people who remember Rachel. Her generous, open-hearted nature will never be forgotten by any who knew her. One simple and probably quite silly story that we were told was of Rachel generously spending an evening picking out knits from the hair of someone who just spent a week helping lead a youth camp. That was so Rachel. It's so hard to describe Rachel in a few words. She was endlessly generous, always good company, and always interested in everybody. You always felt that you mattered when you were talking with Rachel. We'd like to finish by sharing some words which some of you may have seen, because it was written by Ruth McHugh and posted on the blog that many of us have been reading over the last few weeks. It was Ruth who told us the knit story. But Ruth said, "My friend Rachel, faith shining through dark times, inspiring others, telling others. Faith big enough to move mountains and a love to live by. We can only say how privileged we feel to have had Rachel in our lives and to have been able to call her our friend.
So much, everybody. I know we are in church, but I feel a round of applause coming on. Thank you so much. We're going to worship again now. We're going to sing a song which speaks of the amazing grace of God, a grace that Rachel knew, a grace which held her throughout her life, but particularly over these last few weeks. So let's stand as we sing Amazing Grace.
Will be
Please do take a seat. We talked about exotic places, exotic experiences earlier on, and we're now going to celebrate and remember Rachel's life in the USA and then move to Darlington. So if I can ask Jill and Jane to come up. But before we hear from Jill and Jane, we're going to hear from a very special friend of Paul and Rachel's, Kim from the USA.
My name is Kim Glasser. I live in the US and I would like to share a few memories I have of Rachel. In 1999, Paul and Rachel moved to Chapel Hill. Paul was studying at the University of North Carolina. Rachel was not working at the time and had lots of free time. One day, she wandered over to Franklin Street, the main street in downtown Chapel Hill. She came inside University United Methodist Church, the church our family attended, and the church where I was teaching preschool. As she entered, she was delighted to hear the sounds of children. My classroom was the first one on the hall. Rachel popped her head in, smiled, and said, "Good morning," in her cheerful British accent. It was the beginning of our 23-year friendship. Since Rachel and I both have a background in primary education, I decided to use an acrostic and some pictures to describe some of my memories. I will be using the letters R, A, C, H, E, L. R, rafting trip. One summer, our family and the Manners, a family we frequently traveled with, took Paul and Rachel to the North Carolina mountains. There were 14 of us, including 8 children. We decided to go funyacking, which are inflatable kayaks. There were 2 people in each funyak. Paul and Rachel, being newlyweds, were in one, and the rest of us paired up. It was fun, but the river was swift in places, and it took a little skill, strength, and patience to maneuver. Paul had lots of ideas of how this should be done and kept instructing Rachel on the proper way. She tried her best, but she didn't always agree with all of his ideas. It was a little tense at times. After about an hour or so, we all went ashore for snacks. I took my daughter, Ashley, who was probably about 11 at the time, aside and told her, somewhat jokingly, that in order to save Paul and Rachel's marriage, I needed her to be Paul's funyak partner. She agreed, somewhat hesitantly. After a while, we all got back on the river, everything went smoothly, and we had a great time. A, American cars. Rachel was determined to learn how to drive on the other side of the road in the US. She and I would frequently go out for a ride, and she would always head over to the driver's side, which of course is your passenger side, to get in. I would just stand outside the car, smile, and wait until she realized where she was. Lots of laughter. She quickly learned how to drive on the right side of the road, as we Americans sometimes call it. C, Christmas cake. One year, several of us went to the beach for New Year's weekend. We decided to make traditional family recipes to share. Rachel was eager to make her traditional British Christmas cake. She was an excellent baker, so of course it was delicious. Sharing cultural traditions with each other was always a fun thing we enjoyed together. H, helpful. Rachel loved being helpful. Whether it was volunteering at preschool, hosting guests, or chaperoning teenagers on a church choir trip to California, she loved being involved, getting to know people, and being useful. E, enthusiastic and open to new experiences. Rachel was always eager to experience new things in the U.S., whether it was exploring our towns, dancing and being silly with our children, visiting landmarks, sledding down a neighborhood hill, or just sitting and taking in the moment. Rachel was always enthusiastic and eager to live life to its fullest. L, laughter. As I have been talking to others about Rachel these past few weeks, the one thing everyone has mentioned is her laughter, her smiles, her joy. She was a remarkable woman and my special friend, and I am blessed to have been part of Rachel's life journey. Thank you for letting me share.
For those I haven't met, my name is Jill, and I have the privilege to tell you something about Rachel's life in Darlington. We met in the maternity ward in Darlington Hospital in 2002 and have been friends ever since. With both of us having two boys the same age and having families some distance away, we did so much together over the years. That's what my memories of Rachel revolve around, everyday things. Day trips out, whatever the weather, scraped knees, overpriced ice creams, arguments about whose turn it was, and best of all asleep in the car on the way home. Rachel, as has been said before, was always way more organized than me and was often able to provide a towel, a change of clothes, a potty, or whatever else might be needed. And my boys always wanted something from the Ryan's picnic. Days out still continue today, where Sam's love of photography and Fergal's modeling skills are put to the test. These are simple recollections of great times. We also joined in with a number of local groups, breastfeeding group, ABC here at St. Andrews, music with Mummy, playgroup, which was frequently attended by, among others, Spider-Man, Captain Scarlet, Iron Man, a fireman, a doctor, and Sportacus. The dressing up often continued at our house, and Rachel was very forgiving when Ben returned home with an indelible ink moustache drawn on his face. We often swapped children and siblings to ensure that the boys were able to attend various groups and activities, and the taxi service continues to this day, although sometimes it now includes the older boys driving. Performance and musical theme continued as the boys grew up and has shaped Ben and Connell's life and studies post sixth form. Rachel and I were often to be found misbehaving at the back of a choir or orchestra concert. And we also have enjoyed singing together in various performances, including here in church, Christmas services, Ollie Murs, Jason Donovan, and Bananarama, where we amazingly knew all of the words. I do look forward to attending many more Ryan and or Dean performances, as the standard of performance has certainly improved over the years. My boys will tell you that due to my lack of baking skills, they remember Rachel, as a lot of you do, for cakes. After many disastrous birthday attempts, Rachel stepped in with a showstopper, and from then on, I didn't even need to ask. And the cakes were often provided, even when it wasn't anyone's birthday. But these must, of course, have to be eaten with a cake fork. However, her baking skills did not extend to cocktail making, and we got the quantities incorrect for Pimm's on a number of occasions, although Rachel always blamed me. Cake also featured in our local book group, of which Rachel was a stalwart and long-standing member. Our regular meetings were a great source of discussion, friendship, and food, especially Rachel's baking. Her love of books, well, most books, and great communication skills were clearly evident. With all these indulgences, we also needed a way of burning off some of our excess calories.
And after a brief venture into running, we both find friendship and much enjoyment and often much hilarity at regular aerobics classes with Mel. Rachel was always up for a challenge and did these things with a smile and lots of laughs. Whether this involved running the Race for Life, axe throwing with scouts, swimming in the North Sea on New Year's Day, taking part in many quizzes, which the Ryan team often won, or heading out into the Faroe Islands, I'm still not sure how Caroline persuaded Rachel to get into a boat. Caroline was always the cool aunt, who more often than not took all the boys out in her sports car. My husband will tell you of a time when he was being assessed in A&E and I was out of town. Rachel dropped everything and came to sit with him, when you could do those sort of things. She also assisted us when the boys were unwell with odd rashes, which turned out to be flea bites, or hospital admissions. Simple acts of kindness, and I was honoured to be able to renew some of my rather rusty nursing skills more recently to help Rachel and Paul. With our children almost grown up, we were able to do some more grown-up things too. Our last year trip to Chelsea, the flower show, not the football, was a recent highlight. We had plans and ideas to do so much more. And Rachel would, of course, want us all to carry on with our lives. And we will. It just won't be the same without her. But I am hoping that many of you here will join me for dog walks, barbecues, singing, afternoon teas, garden visits, walks to see the local Christmas lights with mulled wine and hip flasks. You've got to try it. Theatre trips and spa visits, and simply tea and chat in our garden or kitchen. We will all miss Rachel so much. And as for the boys, it will be Colin the Caterpillar cakes from now on. Or maybe I will be inspired by Rachel and give birthday cakes another go.
My name's Jane, and I'm a member of St Andrew's Church here. Unlike Jill, I don't remember when I first met Rachel, but it was at least 20 years ago. And very early on, she invited me out for a meal with others to celebrate her birthday. And that typified Rachel's approach to people, to welcome them, to involve them, to make them feel at home, and to offer them hospitality. And as has been said a few times already, plenty of cake and tea always thrown in. All of you will probably agree with me that Rachel liked to chat. In fact, once she got going, she could chat for England to anybody and about anything. But at the same time, she was also a good listener, quick to pick up when people needed a sympathetic ear, a shoulder to cry on, or some common sense advice. You've already heard that Rachel was a born organizer, and she used her skills a lot in this church. Most young mums, when they have a toddler, have their hands pretty much full all day long. But she and Paul thought it would be a good idea, with a toddler, to invite a choir of young people from America to come over to England to perform Godspell in various venues. So with Ben in a buggy, they set to organising venues and hosts and itineraries and goodness knows what else for these visitors. And Rachel continued over the years to head up church social and fundraising events and concerts. On Christmas Day in both 2019 and 2020, she and Paul and Ben and Sam together cooked and served a fabulous Christmas dinner for local people who otherwise might have been on their own for lunch. And again, as a young mum, she threw herself into the life of our church parent and toddler group, bringing first Ben and then Sam, as well as any other children that she happened to be looking after at the time. And once they started at school, she returned as a leader. We benefited from her artistic talents in so many ways. She could rustle up palm trees in no time at all out of a pair of old tights, some wrapping paper and green card for an Elmer the Elephant wall display. And she brought her creativity, as well as her sense of fun, to much of what she did in church. No more so than as a member of our Family at Four team, who led a monthly service in church for families with young children. And they did that for 10 years. There were craft activities, imaginative ways to pray and tell stories. And there was, of course, her uninhibited singing of songs with actions. And along with several other people not sitting too far from me, they may have embarrassed Ben and Sam at times. Children get to that age where parents can be embarrassing. And after all, it is one of the key roles of parents to be embarrassing to their children, isn't it? Anyway, at Family at Four, Rachel was in her element. She could, though, also do less upfront and over-the-top things, like admin, and she worked in our church office for a time as a highly efficient parish administrator. And she has served several stints on the PCC, including a period as its secretary. She was forthright in speaking her mind and engaging in discussion, always seeking to make things happen. We've heard that she trained as a teacher, and at various times she has volunteered and worked in and around Darlington in a playgroup, a nursery school, and several primary schools. She took great pride in doing a good job and was passionate about educating youngsters. Staff at Winfield School remember her as being hardworking, friendly, extremely competent, and always smiling. When our Sunday morning services went online during the pandemic, Rachel was one of our star members of the Stream team who produced online services for our church family and beyond. And I think it was during that time that she developed a desire to think and study more deeply and to share her insights about God with others. Her well-crafted words and her wonderful everyday illustrations helped to bring the Bible to life. Once we were able to get back to church, she and Paul did a training course on leading services, which she was just beginning to put into practice in a wonderfully relaxed and natural way. This, in addition to everything else she did during church services, her lovely singing voice, which has enhanced our worship so much, with Paul and Rachel introducing new worship songs from New Wine to our church family, and her faithful participation in prayer ministry and baptism services. But I think the role that's been the best fit for all of Rachel's considerable gifts and experience and compassion and faith has been most recently as our Darlington CAP Debt Centre Manager. CAP stands for Christians Against Poverty and is a national organisation that works with local churches to help set people free from debt and poverty by offering them practical help and companionship and a chance to hear the gospel. After she'd done some training, she set up our centre almost single-handedly during the pandemic. And that speaks volumes for her and her courage and determination. She found volunteers to help. She publicised the work. She encouraged support from lots of other churches in Darlington. And I observed her speaking passionately about the work to potential grant funders and entering into very robust discussion with our local MP. In 18 months of tireless commitment in the role, she had begun to see people set on the road to recovery from debt. There are very few activities and groups in this church that Rachel has not been involved in some way, in the last 20 years. There is so much more that could be said, but I hope I've managed to say something about how God has used her in this place, used both who she was and how she was to bless so many other people. And to finish on a more personal note, Rachel, I hear your hearty laugh and I see your engaging smile. I admire your can-do attitude and your no-nonsense approach. I love your flapjack recipe and every other cake that you have baked and I have been lucky enough to sample. I recall your zest for living and just how much you crammed into your life. I see your love and faith in God in action, in your love and care for people. And I am grateful to have been just one of so many of us whose path through life has crossed yours.
Thank you so much, Kim, Jill and Jane. I've now got a special message from Mark East, the vicar here at St Andrews. I'm really sorry, he says, I cannot share it with you personally today because the COVID virus has finally caught up with me and with several others from our church family. But I wanted to be with you in word and thought. We're all here with a mixture of emotions. Yes, Rachel, Paul, Ben and Sam want this to be a celebration of all that she is to us as a family, as a friend, as a colleague. But we also have to acknowledge our disbelief, our incomprehension that Rachel is no longer physically with us. That is something we're going to journey through over the coming months and years. But what has been a great help to me thus far has been Rachel's absolute faith and trust in her Lord Jesus, who has enabled her to journey through the last few months with such peace, grace, integrity, and strength. I want us to truly celebrate her life today, both as her vicar, but perhaps more especially as one of many, as one among many whom we would call Rachel our friend. She was truly a great, caring and compassionate friend. Her smile, her love, her genuineness made her easy to become a friend. One of the first opportunities I had to know Rachel and Paul after I arrived here 10 years ago was to go down with them to a new wine worship leaders training programme near Stockport. I knew then that she and Paul were people I could trust, and we had a similar desire to see God at work in this church. Rachel has given so much to this church, whether helping out at ABC, in administration in the office, as a key member of the family at four teams, which was always good going to their house for planning meetings because it meant the homemade cake would inevitably appear. Over the last 2 years, she was part of our online services team and also trained with Paul to lead services. The newer role she took on was as Darlington CAP Debt Centre Manager, and she has established and set such good foundations, and it will continue and flourish in the future. There'll be many other big and perhaps even unnoticed ways that Rachel has made a really positive difference to our individual and church family lives. And as we continue to share and celebrate our wonderful friend, give thanks for her life. May we all draw comfort from her faith and trust in Jesus, who enabled her to journey through this life and into her eternal life, with him, knowing that all was well with her soul. And so we're going to move now to our next worship song. It was a song very close to Rachel's heart. Many of us from St Andrew's remember her speaking about this song at a Songs of Praise event some years ago. She recalled the year 2005. As her and Caroline's mum was dying, she was heavily pregnant with Sam. Sadly, Nancy didn't get to meet Sam. She passed away just a couple of weeks before he was born. And she recalled the line, "From life's first cry to final breath." This now takes on a new meaning for Rachel. Because as she took her final breath, she had faith that Jesus did indeed command her destiny. And she had a faith that she was indeed placing herself in his hands. So let's stand and sing "In Christ Alone." invite you to read from the Gospel of John. Thank you.
This reading is from the book of John, John 14, verses 1 to 4. Don't be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. My Father's house has room to spare. If that weren't the case, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? When I go to prepare a place for you, I will return and take you to be with me, so that where I am, you will be too. You know the way to the place I am going. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
You know how they talk about teachers having eyes in the back of their heads? Well, I've been sat here all the way through the service so far. And what those of you who are sitting in the expensive seats probably don't realise is that this is kind of see-through. So I've been sitting there with Rachel looking directly at me, which is at one and the same time deeply reassuring and really quite intimidating. Those of you who don't know me, my name is Alison, and for a number of years I was part of this church here in St. Andrews. Rachel and Paul and I arrived in Darlington at roughly the same time, and of people as a similar age and a similar background, I was teaching at the time too, we immediately clicked, and there followed from there on many, many cups of tea and trips out and all kinds of things. We even helped each other move house on several occasions, the most memorable of which I think being the day that I moved out of my little house in Darlington. We'd hired a van, which Paul was supposed to be driving, only Paul had food poisoning, so Rachel had to ended up having to drive the van. That also involved my beautiful godson, Ben, who was only about 18 months old at the time, being dumped at my house with my mother, who went, I haven't had to deal with a baby for a long time. So in the absence of a playpen, we put Ben in a vacant box. So very many memories of Rachel. So many memories that so many of you have shared today. And what a picture of Rachel's extraordinary life we've shared together this afternoon. That life that just shone out of her. We've heard words like kindness, generosity, laughter. Oh, that laugh that I don't think any of us will ever stop hearing in our heads when we think of Rachel. But so many other things too, the way that her faith too shone from her. She was somebody who made an impact on so many lives. There are people here amongst us today who have known her since she was a tiny baby. And people here probably who only met Rachel once or twice, but she made such an impact on you that you felt that you had to be here today to pay your respects. That was the kind of woman that she was. And so it seems so strange to think that she's not here with us anymore, that that vitality and that presence has gone from our lives. Everything on earth has its own time and its own season. There is a time for birth and death, for planting and reaping, for crying and laughing, weeping and dancing. Last time I saw Rachel was on the 11th of February, and that was actually the day that she went for the scan on the lump in her neck. And I was working on my little house in Darlington. She popped in for a cuppa, like we've done hundreds of times before. And I was upstairs, I don't know what I was doing, sanding the bathroom door, something like that. And so she sat at the top of the stairs and we chatted while I worked. She told me she was on her way to the hospital. She told me that she was frightened about what they might find. And she even told me that she'd been thinking about her funeral. And I'm ashamed to say that in that moment, I didn't take her as seriously as I should have done, because it seemed so impossible to me that it was that it could be anything major or life-threatening. But Rachel knew even then, even before, I think, she went to the hospital. And as we all know, within less than 7 weeks, she'd gone. And to me, as I'm sure still to many of you, it feels impossible. Impossible that it happened so quickly, but also impossible that she's not here anymore. My brain just won't make sense of it. Every now and again, it just goes, does not compute. It just doesn't make any sense. It seems so unfair. But Rachel, who many years ago could say with the psalmist, "My times are in your hands," was at peace with it. She knew that there is a time for everything under heaven, a time for love and for hate, for war and for peace, a time for crying and laughing, a time for birth and a time for death. Rachel knew and trusted that God makes everything happen at the right time, not the right time for us, but in God's perfect timing. Rachel trusted God with her death, just as she had trusted him with her life for many, many years. And if her time was to be shorter than might have been expected, then Rachel was more okay with it than any of the rest of us. And Paul will tell you that she died as she lived. Once she had all the facts, she made a plan, and she got on with it. But in spite of everything that was happening to her body, she was at peace with it. She was able to say, "It is well with my soul." There are many of us here who, over these past couple of months, have prayed with every fiber of our being that Rachel would be healed. Perhaps some of you who are not accustomed to praying have prayed for Rachel because she meant so much to you. And the fact that Rachel is not here anymore amongst us might feel like a disappointment. It might feel like a letdown. But Rachel wanted us all to know that that wasn't the way she saw it. She was carried through those last weeks on the wave of all of your prayers and your love. And although there wasn't physical healing for Rachel, the peace that she felt and the acceptance that she felt were a kind of healing. They were a gift from God that allowed her to face her last days in quiet trust and dignity, and to be able to say, "It is well with my soul." We will never be without her. She lives on in our hearts and in our memories, reminding us that time is precious, that we should make the most of every day, that we should invest in our relationships and enjoy life in all its fullness, because none of us knows when our time will come. The writer of Ecclesiastes tells us, "The best thing we can do is to always enjoy life, because God's gift to us is the happiness we get from our food and drink and from the work that we do." And as we've heard, so many people gained great happiness from Rachel's food, especially the cake. But I have good news for you, friends, because if his simnel cake is anything to go by, she has passed that talent on to Sam. Where is Sam? Where is he hiding? She's passed that talent on to Sam. So Sam, you have a lot to live up to, my friend. But although the writer of Ecclesiastes says that we should always enjoy life, he also says that there's time for weeping and time for mourning. And although this is a celebration of Rachel's life and all that it held, it's okay that there are tears and that there are questions. Again, the writer of Ecclesiastes talks about how God has shown us the beginning and the end, and he's put those questions into our hearts. And so those of you who are wrestling with those questions about why this has happened, it's okay. You can bring them to God, and God will help you. You won't necessarily get the answers that you're looking for, but God will help each and every one of us to live with those questions well. We'll never understand what's happened. We'll never understand why Rachel's body failed so quickly. But all of that's okay. Rachel wanted us to know that when our prayers don't seem to have been answered, when things don't go the way we hoped, that's when faith really hits the road. Those are the times in which we really need to trust God the way Rachel did, and to have that peace that she knew in those final days of her life, and knowing that it was well with her soul, that she was able to go home to the God that she'd loved all her life, knowing that it was well. And in time, each of us, I hope, will also be able to come to that place of peace with our questions, so that we can say with her, "It is well with my soul." We're going to have some time to reflect now. And there are two songs that we're going to listen to, both of which became very important to Rachel and to Paul in these last months, although Paul says that they were already listening to them last year before any of us had any idea that any of this was going to happen. The first song is called "Even If," and that's very much the message that Rachel wanted us to hear. That even if things don't happen the way we expect them to, even if it looks like God has let us down, we can still trust him, because ultimately he knows what he's doing. Let me just read the words of one of the verses. They say it only takes a little faith to move a mountain. Well, good thing. A little faith is all I have right now. But God, when you choose to leave mountains unmovable, oh, give me the strength to be able to sing, "It is well with my soul." I know you're able, and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone. So we're going to hear "Even If," and "It is well with my soul."
They say sometimes you win some, sometimes you lose some. And right now I'm losing bad. I've stood on this stage night after night, reminding the broken it'll be alright. But right now, oh, right now I just can't. It's easy to sing when there's nothing to bring me down. But what will I say when I'm held to the flame like I am right now? I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand. But they say it only takes a little faith to move a mountain. Well, good thing. little faith is all I have right now. God, when you choose to leave mountains unmovable, oh, give me the strength to be able to sing. It is well.
Time.
We're going to spend some time in prayer now, giving thanks to God for Rachel's life and for all that she was, and praying for God's comfort for each of us. As a response at the end of each section of our prayers, when I say, Lord, hear us, would you respond, Lord, graciously hear us. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Almighty and intimate God, you start where we are, with doubts, with faith, with anger, with resignation. And you surprise us when you accept in us what we cannot even acknowledge to ourselves. You know us better than we know ourselves, and by your grace, all things may be healed. Loving God, we give thanks for Rachel, for all that she was, all the things, all the different facets of her life that we've heard about this afternoon, for her kindness, her generosity, her practical help, her extraordinary baking skills, her interest in everyone and everything, and her willingness to go the extra mile for anyone she encountered. And we give thanks for her faith, that faith which she stood on like a rock throughout her life, that faith which radiated out from her like a light, and that faith which enabled her to face these last weeks of her death, of her life, with peace and acceptance. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. We give thanks for all the lives that she touched. As a family member, as a friend, as a teacher, in all the different contexts that she worked, through all her work here at St. Andrews, and in her work at CAP in recent times. May all those people who were impacted by Rachel and by her faith continue to be inspired by her example and by her faith. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. In these very difficult days and weeks, we pray for all who mourn for Rachel, for all of us here in this place, and for all who weren't able to be with us today. We know that Rachel would have been the first to come and comfort us. And so, Lord, we pray for your comfort for each one of us, especially for Rachel's family, for Colin and Caroline, for our Aunt Mary, for Paul and Ben and Sam, and the wider family. We pray that you would help them in these days and help them to come to a place where they can learn to live around the gap that Rachel has left. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. And Lord, where we have questions, where we have doubts, where we have perhaps feelings of anger or regrets,
Lord, we lay all those things before you. We may not know all the answers. We may not know all the answers this side of heaven. But help us to be inspired by Rachel, by that peace that she experienced, and her acceptance of whatever life held. Lord, we pray that for each one of us, you would give us that peace in our hearts, your peace, which passes anything that human thought can understand or that earth can offer us, but that you would fill us with that peace and help us to come in time to a place of acceptance and a place of trust. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Let's hold silence together for a moment or two as we bring our own thoughts and prayers before God in this place that Rachel loved so much. And let's join all our prayers together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Alison. We've come now to our final worship song. We're going to sing There Is a Redeemer. And we're going to focus particularly on the last verse. When I stand in glory, I will see his face. There I'll serve my King forever in that holy place. And, well, we wish them luck up there. As she arrives with her spiral-bound notebook, her pen, having already fully read and digested the issues at hand, around the heavenly table, as someone comes up with an idea, might be a bit wacky, her eyes will roll. Well, it's an idea. How exactly will that work? Let's stand and sing of our Redeemer, the Redeemer who Rachel knew and loved.
There is a Redeemer.
Thank you. If you'd like to take a seat. We're coming now to our closing words. Please remember the collection plate at the back of church for St. Teresa's Hospice. And just a reminder that we are all invited to join Paul and the family at King's Church for Rachel's afternoon tea style refreshments. I'm going to say these closing words, but they're there in your order of service for you to take away. Rachel, into the darkness and warmth of the earth, we lay you down. Into the sadness and smiles of our memories, we lay you down. Into the cycle of living and dying and rising again, we lay you down. May you rest in peace, in fulfillment, in loving. May you run straight home in God's embrace, into the freedom of wind and sunshine. We let you go. Into the dance of the stars and the planets, we let you go. Into the wind's breath and the hands of the star maker, we let you go. We love you. We miss you. We want you to be free. Go safely. Go dancing, go singing. Go running home. Amen.